in the right direction at least. And Python all the way. So that's it. I want to jump in and cover as much ground as possible. Most of the stuff I'm going to go into is, oh, so if you haven't seen this, this is, you know, your lovely professor right here. So you guys can give him some crap about that. I'm sure you hadn't seen the hawk all the way up.
No, they haven't.
And if you can't tell, there are silver glittery sparkles at the bottom. I can see here, you can't there. So you can give him some shit for that.
What happens in Vegas?
Yes, does not stay in
Vegas.
Does not stay in Vegas. Okay, so anyways, I do want to go as quick as possible. There are a lot of exercises. Please ask questions. Most of the stuff I'm going to go into is static. We'll go into the difference between static and dynamic shortly. So if we make a lot of progress today, I'm going to add some dynamic stuff to the end and put on more dynamic. So I'd like to get as far as possible, but we'll see. So the point of this is if somebody gives you a binary and goes here. So I want you to be able to look at this binary, get a feel for it, look at the sections, what's it importing, what's it using, you know, obviously look at the strings. At the same time, I want you to be able to, you know, disassemble it. So you can look at the assembly, you can rename things to make more sense, to help you out, you can group nodes, you can color it. You can convert back to source code to figure out what the programmer actually wrote or something that they could have written that compiled to that. We'll go into a little bit about process memory layout. That's important to understand so you can really get a feel of what's going on and when this process is being, or when the program is being run. You'll do some stuff like figuring out if you have a function, does it take arguments? If so, how many? What type are they? Does it have local variables? If so, what type? And then we'll use a debugger at the end to kind of fill in some of these gaps where, I mean, static is hard. So if you run a debugger and you set a breakpoint, you can kind of fill in these gaps as you go. It's the combination of the two that'll give you the best results. So here's the general outline. Normally when I give this, it's like a 3-hour crash course kind of a deal. And it's just really intense, like 3 hours. The exercises, like, give you guys like 20 minutes on, 30 minutes on. Don't have that luxury here, so you're gonna have like 5 minutes. But that's okay. So the format is, we're going to learn a little bit, we're going to do an exercise, try to implement it, learn a little bit more, do another exercise. I really like to make it as hands-on as possible, because if I just do 2 full days on reverse engineering and you guys don't do anything, you will learn absolutely nothing. So try to incorporate as much as possible. Anyways, that's the outline, PE and ELF, which are the file formats. Anyways, well, we're going to do it, so don't worry. So the first 15 slides or so are a little more overview, so bear with on the first like 15, and then we start jumping into exercises right away. So again, some quick high-level stuff, static versus dynamic. So when you're trying to figure out something, what a binary does or how it works or reverse engineer it, there's two general approaches. Static is you're just looking at the disassembly. You've got a whole bunch of code, you're just staring at it. You figure it out just by looking at it. There's nothing going on, hence the term static. Dynamic is when, if you were to actually run this program and then analyze the process that's being run. So in real time you can see, like when you debug some of your code, right? So in real time you can see the registers or the stack, or you can see what's actually going on in real time. So those are the two main formats. Static is a little bit safer because you're not obviously running it. If you do run it and it's malware or something like that, obviously it's a little more dangerous. But just run it in a VM and you're fine. So some general tools for this. If you're going to disassemble something, IDA is IDA Pro, the interactive disassembler. It's really like the only option you have. IDA is amazing. I could do several talks just on IDA, it's awesome. It's pretty much the tool of choice. For debuggers, it depends on what OS you're on. On Linux, GDB is sort of like the default. On Windows, you could be WinDebug, Immunity, Ality, IDA, whatever just you happen to like, that's all. So there are some common traits that are going to come with these tools. A good disassembler will have a common set of features. It'll let you comment some lines when you figure out what it's doing. IDA in particular will let you group, IDA shows you a graph format, we'll go into it later, but it'll let you group nodes and rename things, you can change function prototypes and stuff like that. Similarly, debugger will have, you know, some common features. You can set your breakpoints, you can step into and over stuff, you can examine structured exception handler chain, you can search memory for certain contents. So again, disassembler or debugger, static versus dynamic. But okay, really, that's about all I want to talk about this, so we're going to get into it and do some exercises. So we're going to go into these pretty heavily. That's just a quick little high-level overview of static versus dynamic. So one of the first things here is PE versus ELF. So PE is what Windows uses. It's the portable executable. So .exe, .dll, these are all PE files. There's actually only one bit that separates an executable and a DLL. They're basically the exact same. For Linux, Unix, Apple, ELF, the executable and linkable format, that's just what like Linux uses for their .exe. So there's PE, there's ELF, Windows and Linux. And here's some picture I grabbed from some site, Intel. So the thing to take away from this is we could go really heavily into each of these formats, and you could spend, you know, a week on each format, and but nobody wants to do that, so let's not. The thing to take away from this, just really high level, is that these formats have a bunch of fields in them. Each field is going to have some specific value. So there's going to be a field called image base. It's going to have some address. There's going to be a field called, you know, date created. It's going to have some date, whatever. It's a bunch of fields, and there's a bunch of sections. And so if we look back at the picture, can I see the cursor? Yeah, anyways. So you can see whether you're Linux or whether you're Windows, there's a bunch of sections. And these sections have permissions, read, write, execute. And they'll have some other fields and properties associated with them. And they'll have a name, which is just for your sake. Permissions are really important when you go into exploitation. If you want to write your shellcode somewhere, you need to write it to a writable section. If you want to execute shellcode, or if you want to redirect control flow somewhere, it has to be executable. So permissions are actually a big deal. Okay, so I think that's okay, cool. So now we jump into some stuff. So that was the first 15 slides. So why is any of that useful? You don't really care. But it actually is. So when you look at a binary, you can get an overview of what it's doing with just some of this information you can just get off the surface. So like what libraries is it loading? Or what libraries is it importing? If it's importing a bunch of socket libraries, you can probably assume that this binary is going to do network communication. And then you can verify that. You can look at what functions it's actually importing from that library. Okay, well it's using, you know, set sock option, accept, send, receive. Okay, so now we're pretty sure that this binary is going to do, you know, network communication. So you can get a high-level overview of what it's probably doing, or you know, throughout its lifetime. At the same time, it's useful if you want to find vulnerabilities and do bug hunting. So if you consider, you did code auditing, right? Yeah. So you know, like string copy and stuff like that. If those are the bugs you're interested in finding, well, you can open up a binary really quickly, look what it's importing, and if you find a bunch of string copies, string cats, and stuff like that, you can immediately go to those functions and work backwards. So for bug hunting, that's also really helpful. Parsing data, data sections for strings, that's extremely helpful in CTFs also. I think there's a slide here in a second. So strings is a big deal, it can help you out a lot. And just by looking at the high-level stuff, you can also usually figure out if it's packed or not. If you have weird section names or weird sizes, or when you look at the imports, if a binary is only importing like four things, that's a huge red flag.
Can you quickly explain for everyone what packing is?
Sure. So if I just compile a regular executable or a regular source code and I have some executable, you're going to be able to, you know, follow through it, and it's going to look like just normal assembly, and it'll make sense. It'll be assembly, so it's complicated, but it's not going to be convoluted or messed up in any weird way. If I pack that executable, whether it be to obfuscate it from you or just to literally make it smaller, it's going to change the way the assembly looks, and it's just going to completely sort of rewrite it and smaller or obfuscate it. So it's going to be really hard to figure out what's going on. That's sort of what it is to be packed. So there's an example of this really quickly. And the tools that you can use to analyze some of this stuff and figure out, you know, what libraries are being loaded, what section names there are, what strings a binary has. At the bottom there, for PE, so for Windows files, CFF Explorer, I highly, highly recommend that. Did you have them download CFF Explorer?
They should all have IDA Pro and CFF Explorer.
Okay, good. So CFF Explorer is an awesome, like, high-level overview tool. IDA will show you all the same stuff. PE file is a cool Python library. And then for ELF files, readelf, object dump, and file, those are useful. Okay, so that was the first 15 slides. Now we're actually going to start doing stuff. So here's a picture of CFF Explorer, and I'm looking at calc, so calculator. And you can see it's section headers. So each section has a name, a virtual size, a virtual address, so on and so forth. So there's the text section, the data section, the relocation section. And then this characteristics column here, this is actually the permissions. So, you know, whatever these bits are, one of them means read, one of them means write, one of them is execute, and so on and so forth. This is if you were to look at the section headers for calc.exe. So, and this is just regular calculator. It's not packed. There's nothing fancy going on here. When we look at the next slide, this is a packed executable. So this has been compressed and maybe or maybe not obfuscated. And you can see the section headers, the name is UPX0, UPX1, and resource. So UPX is a well-known packer. It's sort of like a lot of people use UPX. It's common. It's not, you can undo it really quickly. But just by looking at these section headers, you can figure out that it's packed with, in fact, UPX. So this is a huge red flag when you see something like this. And similarly, on Linux side, if you were to use readelf-S, you'll see the section headers. So the same stuff is represented here. You got your text, your data, your BSS section, you have your permissions. All these same fields you can see in Linux or Windows. The binaries are not the same, but they all sort of have the same stuff and they all sort of work the same way. So they have section names, they all have addresses and permissions and stuff like that. And you can see both the stuff in Linux and Windows. So here's showing what, this is using IDA to see what functions are actually being imported. So if you were bug hunting and you want to find a vulnerability in, you know, Microsoft Office or whatever your application or your target is, let's say you want to approach it via, you know, string copies or something like that, you're going to code audit. So I just did a regular expression filter here for string or anything with str, and you see there's string copy, string cat, stuff like that. So this is one approach you can take to doing that. Oh yeah, and so here's looking at strings. So this is a recent CTF problem. And if you're in IDA and you go to the strings window, so there's something key, wrong call, there's some library names, and then there's get your flag, %s. So you probably want to start from the get your flag, %s, and work backwards. So looking at strings is all these little high-level overviews you can use to give you a quick little insight into the binary are really, really helpful. If you jump straight into the assembly, it's complicated. Okay, so here's the first little exercise. Use CFF Explorer, use IDA Pro, open up numberchecker.exe and numberchecker-packed.exe. You can compare and contrast these a little bit. Look at what one of them imports, and then look at what the packed one imports, and you'll see there's a huge difference on the number of imports, the sections, the type of sections. So just play around with this for like 5 minutes. I'll walk around and answer any questions or something. But play around with CFF Explorer and IDA and get a feel for what this looks like.
If we get the thumb drive, some students can't access the internet.
So oh, really?
Just do the hard copy stuff.
Yeah, sure.
So, if you can't access the internet or you can get the website, raise your hand so you
Thanks.
Say that again? do you have all the tools set up on
your machine? How do we bring them?
What version of the Dropbox? You should be able to create a share.
Let's look at section header.
You
should be able to connect the
app and tackle these problems. You can clearly see the data.
Yeah, that's
Pressing the space key will switch you between graph view and just a dead listing. So the space key will switch that.
It said it failed to display the program in
graph. I have no idea. Okay, so I got to stick to the schedule here because we have almost no time. So one thing I want to show you guys real quick is this is the unpacked version. And if we look at the imports, you can clearly see it's loading from kernel 32, you know, this function, this function, this function, this function. So you can clearly see all this and you can get an overview of what's going on. Now, if we compare this to the packed version, it's completely different. So if we go to the packed version and now we look at the imports, there's only like five or six. So what this is doing is it's using load library to load some particular DLL and then get proc address to load a particular function in that DLL. And at runtime, it builds up that whole list and imports all those functions dynamically. So when you're statically just looking at this, you have no clue what is going on here. Because you know it's going to load some library, then load a bunch of functions. You don't know which ones. This is a lot more complicated than the other one that was nice and clear, and you can see, well, oh, it's clearly doing all this stuff with these functions. So that's the difference between like packed and unpacked and stuff like that. And if you didn't know where the string section was, well, it was on the slide. But it's open subviews strings. Okay, so sorry, I got to stick to the schedule here. Okay, so next we're going to jump into assembly and we're going to actually start, assembly. So there's two main syntax options. There's AT&T and there's Intel. The AT&T format is instruction source destination. So it's going to move EAX into EDX. Intel is the opposite. It's instruction destination source. So it's in this instruction right here, it's going to move into EDX EAX. Some people like one, some people like the other. But it's a well-known fact that Intel is greater than AT&T. So that's not an opinion at all. So anyways, we're going to be using Intel almost, it's widely used. So move into EAX, ECX. So there's a couple little nuances here. When you see these brackets like that, that means dereference the value. So move into EAX, what's pointed to by ECX. So if you're familiar with C and pointers and stuff like that, basically that looks like this instruction right here. EAX gets the dereferenced value of ECX, what it points to. And yeah, please ask questions. Everything builds on its, so you ask questions if you have any. So you can also just use immediate values and memory values as well. So you can move into EAX the value 5, just the straight up number 5. Or you could pass it a particular memory address and dereference it. So move into EDX what's pointed to at this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So just, I mean, I'm not gonna go into a bunch of assembly. Just a handful of instructions here, like I think I talked about 4 or 5, will get you a really, really, really long way. If you just look at calls, you can figure out a whole heck of a lot about what a program is doing. So when you see call, and then some address, that's saying you're calling the function at this address, like you're invoking this function. Another one is compare. So compare EAX to 8. And the compare is left to right. So when you see, if I jump down here for a second to this JLE, jump less than or equal to. So if you saw compare EAX to 8, and then jump less than or equal to this address, you would jump to this address if EAX was less than or equal to 8. So the compares are sort of read left to right. So if you see a jump without any kind of just a regular jump, that's unconditional. That means no matter what, execution is now going to continue at this address. It's unconditional. The conditional jumps are less than or equal to, jump greater than, jump above, jump below. There's a little bit of difference between that. Some are signed, some are unsigned, but it's okay. So you need to understand the compares left to right. Compare EAX to 8, jump greater than. This address would say jump to this address if EAX was greater than 8. Did everybody get that? Okay, because that's actually important. Okay, so we're going to step through this step by step. We're going to figure out what this program does. And then you guys are going to have a little exercise. I'm going to put some more source or some assembly up there. And you guys are going to figure out what the program does, how many arguments it takes, stuff like that. Where are we time wise? Okay, so we're just going to focus on those instructions we know, just those three or four right there. Move, compare, jump, and call. So we're ignoring these first couple instructions up here. That's part of the prologue and epilogue, and we'll discuss that. So we're just going to start at this move. So we're moving into EBP minus 4, the value 4, and it's dereferenced. So we're moving into what EBP minus 4 points to, the value 4. Then we move what's pointed to at EBP minus 8, the value 10, or hex A. Then we move into EAX, what's pointed to at EBP minus 4. So just with the move instruction, we sort of end up with these three little instructions over here. So what we got from that was that two values relative to some pointer EBP have been assigned values. One of them was assigned to 4, one of them was assigned to 10. And then one register, EAX, was assigned a value of what EBP minus 4 points to. Well, we just assigned to EBP minus 4 the value 4, so EAX in this case is equal to 4. So we're going to add two more instructions. So now we hit our first compare, and this compares EAX to what's pointed to at EBP minus 8. So if we read that left to right, it's basically saying, does EAX equal EBP minus 8? And then if jump greater than or equal to this address. So when we compare EAX, which has the value of 4, the pointer at EBP minus 8, what that points to, which is 10, we're saying does 4 equal to 10? And then if jump greater than or equal to, so if 4 is greater than or equal to 10, jump to that address. Else we just continue execution. So 4 is not greater than or equal to 10, so we do not jump to that address. So we just continue executing. If you don't satisfy a condition when it says like jump greater than or equal to, and you're not greater than or equal to, then you just keep on executing. You just fall straight through until you do find some condition that you satisfy. So execution just continues right down. So move into EAX 1. Okay, EAX has the value 1. Now there's an unconditional jump. Jump to whatever this address that ends in 3DC is. This is unconditional. Oops. You're going to take it no matter what. And that is this address right here. So we basically jumped over that instruction that's marked out in red. So we don't know what leave does. We don't know what ret does. Who cares? Okay, so two memory addresses relative to EBP were assigned values. One was a 4, one was a 10. There's a comparison. If the first operand is greater than or equal to the second operand, we take that jump. If not, which is true in our case, we continue execution. EAX gets assigned the value of 1, and then the function returns. So we're going to go a little bit deeper. So we kind of know what's going on, but not really. So we need to go a little bit deeper. So everything in that assembly has a purpose. So move D word pointer, bracket, EBP minus 4, bracket. All that has meaning. So we just said move into what EBP minus 4 points to, a value of 4. But I just sort of ignored this D word pointer part. Well, I mean, it's shown there for a reason. It's not just, taking up space for no reason. So what does that mean? So the brackets we know mean dereference whatever that address is. But dword pointer means something as well. So dword is the size. Pointer just basically means dereference the value, and it's accompanied by the bracket, so that's not new. But dword is the size, which is really important because we can figure out what data type this is. In our case, it was dword. So dword is 4 bytes, or 32 bits. So that's an int. So actually what EBP-4 is pointing to is an integer. So like in your source code, you have int x or whatever you want to call it. It's not a short, it's not a char, that's an int. So we just figured out that data type based off the fact that it said dword. So the types you're going to see are byte, word, dword, and on 64-bit systems, keyword for quad. So that's really important. When it dereferences values, you can figure out the data types that are used in the source code. So we saw that move into dword pointer, the EBP-4, the value of 4. So that address at EBP-4 is getting 4 bytes moved into it with a value of 4. So EBP-4, what that points to is an integer. So our source code probably has some hard-coded, some hard-coded value, an integer of 4. So we have two of those moves, actually. So what this means is there are two ints. We don't know what they're called, x, y, who cares. There's some int x that has a 4, and there's some int y that's 10. So we just figured out two hard-coded local or variable assignments. But we don't know, are these local variables? Are they global? Are they static somewhere? We don't really know where these were actually defined. So we need a little bit of background on a process memory and how it's laid out, and then we can figure out where these were actually defined. So here's our quick little recap so far. We know some in x is equal to 4, some in y is equal to 10. We don't know where they're declared. Then it goes, if 4 is greater than or equal to 10, we jump to some address. But we don't take that jump because 4 is not greater than or equal to 10. We set EAX to 1, and then we unconditionally jump to that main plus 28x, which returns. So we're getting a little closer. Sort of looks like source code-ish. That's much better than that black box on the right. So a little background, just like one or two slides on process memory layout, and we'll be able to fill in a couple more gaps for that first example. So we want to know, why are things relative to EBP and ESP, like why was it EBP minus 4, not ECX minus 4? So why was it EBP? We also want to know, what were those push and pop instructions at the top and at the bottom? And what is this whole leave, ret? If we look at the end here, there's leave and ret, and there's these pushes at the top. So we want to, well, there's a couple of things we still need to fill in before we can actually get full source code. These are two pictures I'm not going to go over. This is Windows process memory layout when it's loaded into memory, what it looks like. And this is the Linux one. These are really good pictures, and the sites are in the bottom right. So if you want to look a little more in depth.
We're going to go in depth into this next week.
Yeah, so you can come back and look at these. These are good pictures. What I want to show you is just this. It's the exact same stuff. It's just without all those other details in there. Within the text section, like in here, they put a whole bunch of stuff that you don't need to know right now. But so, this is a grad class, right?
There are some undergrad classes.
Okay. So you've all had OS and stuff. So there's virtual memory. Every process thinks it's special, has its own whole virtual memory to work with. It really doesn't. But this is what the process looks like in memory, right? Whether it be Linux or Windows, they're a little bit different. The picture's kind of flipped upside down. But they all still have the same sort of stuff going on. The important thing here is that there are these main sections, sort of the text, data, BSS, heap, and stack. So the text is where your actual machine instructions are located. So those assembly instructions we just saw a second ago, those are in the text section. And those permissions are going to be like readable and executable, but not writable. You can write over your own instructions because then you could just change the program at will. So data has the initialized global and static variables. So if I have a global variable int x, that's uninitialized global. That's going to be in the BSS section. But if I have int x equals 10 and it's a global variable, well, now it's going to be in the data section. For local variables though, so if they're not static and they're not global, they're gonna be in the stack. And this grows and shrinks dynamically. It's sort of the program scratch space. It's how you pass arguments to functions and stuff like that. And your heap is dynamic space that you call as a programmer. You manually call malloc or new, and then you manually free something or call its destructor. So this helps you figure out a couple of things we're going to see here in a second. So registers is one of the other things that's important to understand. These are like the 8 or 9 just general registers you're going to see in a 32-bit system. EIP is sort of like what everybody wants. You want to own EIP. In most of your exploitation, it's going to be about trying to hijack EIP. That points to the next instruction to be executed. So like when you're debugging something and you set a breakpoint, EIP is going to be on that current instruction. So if you can hijack EIP and point it to your own code, that's sort of how most of the exploitation goes. You want to point that to your own stuff. But now this helps fill in a couple gaps. So we saw a bunch of stuff was relative to EBP, or in a lot of cases ESP. And that's the stack pointer for ESP and then the base pointer in the case of EBP. And we're going to go over stack frames here in a second. But these two pointers, the stack pointer and the base pointer, point to the top and the bottom of the frame that you're in relative to any function at any given point in time. So they're relative to the function you're in. So that's why they're being referenced that way.
So because they're referenced in relation to EBP, you know they weren't declared as global variables. So they'd be in PSS.
Exactly. That's we're going to see that in a second. But that's exactly correct. Some of the other ones, like EBX is base and ECX is counter and DX is data, those sometimes get used that way.
Just convention.
Yeah, you can usually put whatever you want in them. The compiler may or may not put, you know, some specific thing in ESI and some specific thing in EDI. So don't really count on those being used that way. Certain instructions do require it. But just generally speaking, anything can be in anything except for the ESP and EBP and EIP. So really quickly about the stack. So here's what your general stack frame looks like. And you have ESP pointing to the top of your stack and EBP, the base pointer, pointing to the base or the bottom of your stack. So and local variables are stored on the stack. So what Owen just said a second ago is right. When we see EBP minus something, we're referencing something local to this function stack. So EBP minus something, note that the high addresses are at the bottom in this picture and the low addresses are at the top. So EBP minus something is pointing into the local variable region. Now, if you had seen EBP plus something, you'd be pointing, generally speaking, to the arguments for that function. So you can tell if a function has arguments if you see a reference to EBP plus something. And you can tell if it's referencing a local variable based off EBP minus something. Sometimes you might see the stack pointer being used, like ESP plus 1 or plus 4 or whatever. But either way, you can tell it's referencing these local variables in here based off what EBP means. Debating how much. Anyways, so. Okay, yeah, so when a function cleans up, the function needs to store, so when you call the next function, it has its own EBP and its own ESP. So these values have to be stored some way. So one way to do that is to just push them onto the stack. So when this function is done, it's gonna pop off this stored EBP value, and now EBP is gonna point to whatever this value is, so maybe it points further down the stack somewhere. And we're going to go into this a little more detail in a second. But the takeaway here is that local variables are referenced to EBP minus something, and arguments are EBP plus something. OK, so that's a little bit of background on those. You could go into any of those for as many weeks as you possibly wanted to. But let's try to figure out what this example's stack layout would look like. Then we're going to look back at the code and fill in some more gaps. So here in the beginning, we ignored these first three instructions originally. But now we're going to actually look at them, and particularly this subtract. So we're subtracting from ESP hex 10, so 16. So if we look back at what this would look like, initially ESP has been moved up 16 bytes. So what that means is you have 16 bytes for local variables. If an integer is 4 bytes, maybe you have 4 integers, so that's a total of 16. Maybe you have 16 characters. The point is there's 16 bytes for local variables in this function. Now we know that EBP minus 4 is a local variable, EBP minus 8 is a local variable, and one thing in the registers, EAX is one that it's used to hold the return value for a function. And when a function returns, right before the return is going to move into EAX, whatever that return value is, a 1, a pointer, whatever it is. So the return value is EAX, is either a 1 or a 0 depending on the compare. So based off this compare, EAX gets 1, or it jumps over this, and EAX gets 0. So we fill in a couple more gaps here. And I should have put a recap right there. Anyways, so let's try to figure out what the stack for this function is going to look like. We know it's going to have a saved return value. We know it's going to have a saved EBP value. This is all for the previous function. And we know it has a local variable at EBP minus 4, has the value 4. And we know at EBP minus 8, it has the value 10. So these two local variables right here, we know are the first 8 bytes of the stack frame. And there's 16 total bytes, because that's EBP or ESP minus 16. We have 16 total bytes to work with, 8 of which are used for these two local variables. Yeah, that space is much bigger than that space, but whatever. And we know that there's no EBP plus something. So there's no arguments to this function being used. There's no EBP plus 8 or plus 12 or 16. So no arguments are being passed to this function that we're using at least. So let's try to put it together a little bit more. We're gonna say that the function prototype returns an int because we're returning either a 1 or a 0. Maybe it's returning, you know, a short or a char, but let's call it an int. Now we know there's no arguments being passed here as well. There's no EBP plus something. So now we have an int x is equal to 4, which we know is a local variable because of its EBP reference. And we know we have an int y is equal to 10, which is local again as well. So then we do this comparison. If 4 is greater than or equal to 10, we jump to that address. Otherwise, EAX gets 1 and then jumps to this address, and the function returns. So we're getting pretty close here. It's almost source code. You can see how many arguments, the return type, local variables, a comparison, the return value. You're getting really close. This would probably be all you need to do if you just want to know what this function is doing. But we want to get complete source for right now. So I have to do a quick side note about the way assembly marks things. If comparisons get translated opposite, so in source code, if I have this if x is greater than y, that's going to end up in assembly looking like compare x to y, but then the conditional jump is going to be opposite. So in source code it says if x is greater than y, in assembly it's going to be less than or equal to. So it's checking to see if that condition is not true, and if so, skip that whole section of code, rather than checking to see if it is true and then execute, then fall into there. So right here when we say if x is less than or equal to y, it's going to do the comparison and then do the opposite, jump above. And if so, it's going to jump over that. So it's checking to see if that condition is false, the exact opposite, and jump over it. So when you see jump above, then you think, oh, well, the programmer really wrote it's less than or equal to. So that's how you kind of work those back and forth. So what we had a second ago here, we saw jump greater than or equal to, we have this greater than or equal to, so that's not actually correct. It's actually in source code checking to see if it's less than. So when we compare that EAX to EBP minus 8, jump greater than or equal to, it's actually checking to see if it's less than. And if so, it's moving into EAX1. So this actually ends up looking like that. So that's that whole function. You complete source code. So it's a little tricky. It takes a little background knowledge. But after you do it a couple times, you don't even, there's no real reason to actually write the source code out. Like you can just look at that and figure out what it's doing. But in doing this, you figure out data types, you figure out arguments, you figure out return values. So you can go from assembly to source, and it's a valuable skill. Okay, so here's another exercise for you guys. We'll take about 5 minutes. Here's a function, and I want you to produce the source code for this. So there's a couple things. How many local variables, if any? How many arguments, if any? What types are they? And there's one instruction we haven't covered, which is LEA. Just pretend that this LEA is the same thing as this right there. So think about that, stare at it for a minute. Is it EBP plus or minus? Or is it, what size is it? So try to write the whole function prototype, and it's the whole function. Yeah, plus 8 is the first argument, plus 12 is the second argument, and in increments of 4 like that. Questions about anything? Okay, a couple more. 2 minutes. Yeah.
Why does this function pop and not ring? Is it because of the argument?
Right. Yeah.
So there's no sub ESP in the beginning. So there's no reason to like add back to it. And so what leave actually, in the previous function, there was a leave instruction that moves into the stack pointer, the base pointer, and then does the pop automatically.
Okay.
There was just no reason to add that stack pointer. Yeah, so just to the pop. Okay, so who can tell me, start to finish, what this function looks like? Yeah, go for it.
It adds two arguments together and returns one.
Perfect, exactly. So this is what the function was right here, sum. It just int x, int y, and it returned x plus y. So the compiler used that LEA, EDX, EAX times 1 for efficiency. It's faster. It could have easily done add EDX, EAX, and it would have made just a little more sense. But you'll see that kind of stuff all the time.
So what is the purpose of the times 1?
The times 1. LEA takes a specific format. It's just something plus something times something. So it, since it's not actually wanting to you know, multiply by 2 or 3 or 4, just use 1. It's probably a cycle faster. Like that may take 4 cycles and add may take 6, or I don't know. But it's just a slight bit more efficient. That's why I used it. And you'll see those optimizations like all the time.
Are you going to cover like inline optimization?
No.
So why don't use add or some other instruction?
It's just that LEA is a little bit faster, so the compiler was just optimizing that. That's all. It very well could have used add. It's the exact same thing. EAX contains the return value, so with that LEA or add, EAX already has the return value. So it's not just adding, it's actually returning the addition of those two. And no local variables were used. There was no EBP minus anything. It's just referencing EBP plus something. So there's no local variables in this at all.
So is there any problem related to the sequence of x plus x add y or x plus y or y plus x?
Yes, because EBP plus 8, if we look at that stack picture, so EBP points right here. So plus 4 points to the return address, plus 8 points to the beginning of the very first argument. So when we have EBP plus 8 is in EDX is the first argument, and EBP plus 12 or hex C is in the EAX. So this actually adds into the second one, the first one. Into the second one, the first one. I mean, in the case of the add, no, it doesn't. But in the case of the order in which they're being referenced, the plus 8 and the plus C, that is the second argument, that is the first argument. So if those were used in any other way, it would make a difference. But not in the case of an add. Okay, so, yeah.
If you have another argument, because it's telling you the location, like for XC, for X8, it's telling you that it is in fact an argument. If you had, like, in the last example, a comma XC, that tell you that it's adding 12 and 8? Like,
say it again?
Like, would you be able to find out the value of what X and Y were if it had, like, comma XC and comma X8 next to it in the previous example?
Like if there was, I'm not sure I understand. So you're saying like if it was moving into EAX a particular value?
I'm just saying like how would you, like what would it look like if you could find out the value of what those integers were?
So, okay, so a great question. So in this case, you can't, there's no idea. So even look at the source code, this is just saying sum, int x, int y, and return the addition of those. So you know, like there's no local variables. There's nothing actually hard coded there. That's just going to return the addition. So there's no way to figure that out. Now, in runtime, you could set a breakpoint when you hit that function, and then see what happened to be passed to it that time, or what happens to be passed to it next time. But just looking at this particular function right now, I mean, it's just going to add it and return it. You have no idea. Yeah.
Can we get from the first line like no EBP? That there's no local variable, like just from that?
You can because, so great question. So there's two instructions here. Push EBP, so save EBP so I can pop it off later. I'm storing this for right now. And then move into the base pointer, the stack pointer. So it's gonna move EBP up a little bit. So there's two instructions there. Let me go back to the previous Okay, so now note, this one starts with 3. There's the same push, the same move, but this one has a sub ESP, so it's making room for those local variables. Since the second one doesn't have that subtraction, from that you can tell there's no local variables. So yeah, exactly, that's good. Okay, cool, yeah, those are great questions. Anything else? Okay, cool, so 15 minutes left or so? Okay, cool, great, so we're doing good. Okay, so all this function stuff brings up the question about functions and how they work and how those arguments get pushed on the stack and why and stuff like that and what that EBP and that return value are. So we're gonna talk about functions a little bit. Remember this tiny little picture here? Main is calling sum and it's passing it the 5 and a 7. Just remember that. So yeah, looking at that previous exercise, we want to know how functions are handled in particular. We do know that EAX holds a return value, and we do know that arguments, from the function's point of view, begin at EBP plus 8. But how do those arguments get there, and how are they removed? Does the function clean them up, or the calling function clean them up, or stuff like that? So there's two main calling conventions that are used, cdecl and stdcall. Excuse me. Cdecl originates from C, and arguments are pushed on the stack right to left. Stdcall is from Microsoft, and arguments get pushed on the stack right to left, so everything's the same. The difference is the way they clean up. So in cdecl, the calling function cleans up. So what we just saw was Linux code I compiled on like GCC or something. This function does not remove any arguments that were passed to it. It just cleans up its own stuff. So it's not worried about what was passed to it. And the function that had called it, like main, would then clean up the stack after calling that sum function. In stdcall, that sum function would then clean up the arguments that were passed to it. So the only difference is who cleans up the stack, the calling function or the function that was called. So what that does mean, though, for stdcall is that the function being called must know how many bytes ahead of time it's expected to receive, so then it can then clean up those many bytes. That's the only difference. So okay, this is that main function. It's just return sum and it passed it a 5 and a 7. This return sum and it passed it a 5 and a 7. So one thing to note is that depending on the compiler you use, GCC, so on Linux, tends to move into the stack pointer plus something an argument, while Visual Studio tends to push an argument. So it's the exact same thing. So these two instructions right here in Visual Studio would have been push 7, push 5, rather than move into ESP plus 4, 7, and then move into ESP 5. But arguments get pushed right to left regardless. So when we called sum, we passed it a 5 and a 7. So right to left is going to say push the 7 and then push the 5. So that's why we see the 7 going to the stack pointer plus 4, and then the 5 going into the stack pointer itself. So that's right to left. So here's what that looks like. We're inside of main. It has the return value in EBP, and it moved into, here's main. You can see subtract from ESP 8. So there's room for two integers in this case. And it moves into ESP plus 4, the value at 7. So if ESP is pointing to the top of the stack, ESP plus 4 is going to be 4 bytes down. We move the 7 there, and then it moves into ESP the 5. So this is the way the stack is set up when it makes that call to sum. So, ESP, okay, it's very functional. Okay, so yeah, we know that the functions reference their local arguments and their local variables in the arguments via ESP and EBP. So like I was mentioning earlier, every function has its own prologue and epilogue to adjust ESP and EBP to the correct values for its particular function. It's gonna do this little prologue and epilogue to set those values up, so it's always pointing to the right stuff relative to its function. So the prologue, yeah, exactly like you asked earlier. So it pushes EBP to save that value so I can later pop it off. So it's just saving it to the stack. Then it moves into the base pointer, the stack pointer. So think about this visually for a second. So you got your stack pointer somewhere up here and your base pointer somewhere down here. If you move into the base pointer, what's pointed, the value of the stack pointer, they're going to have the same value. So EBP suddenly points to the top of the stack now. Then when you do your subtract from ESP, now you're in your own stack frame, you have room to work with. So then at the end, when if you look at the epilogue, you add to ESP something. Okay, now they're back down level again. And then you pop EBP off the top, and EBP goes back down. So you just shift up to work in the new stack frame, and you shift down to work in the previous one. And this happens all the time with all these function calls, so you're relative to your own stuff. There's a second version of the epilogue, which just does leave. Leave is the exact same thing as those two instructions, move into ESP, EBP, and then pop. It's probably just a couple of cycles faster. So, okay, here's where we left off a second ago. As soon as call sum, that as soon as you call sum, so the next instruction to be executed gets pushed onto the stack. So when that, so when sum finishes and returns, it's going to know where to go. So this is right as we called sum, nothing's been executed yet. We are on this push EBP instruction right here. So, oops, wrong direction. So we're going to push EBP. Okay, so EBP has now been stored. And notice the stack pointer moves up with it. So we pushed EBP, and now we're going to move into the base pointer, the stack pointer. That's going to move them up. So they're both pointing to the same thing. They both have the same value now. So they're both pointing to the top of the stack. So now, if there was going to be local variables, then the subtract would have happened right here, and there would be one more step. But there's not. That's okay. So now we're going to move into EAX, what's pointed to at EBP plus 12, aka the second argument. Okay, so EAX has 7. EDX gets the first argument, which is 5, and that LEA instruction, or add, makes a total 12. So that's all that happened in that instruction, in that function. EAX is the return value, it already has 12, so that's good to go. The function has to clean up now, so it's going to pop EBP. This saved base pointer value is going to be popped into EBP, and EBP now points back down to its original value somewhere down there at the bottom. And now it's going to return. And what return does is it pops that address on the top of the stack and puts it into EIP. So, huge red flag, if you're storing, the address is going to be executed on the stack. If you can own the stack in some way, then you can own EIP. So, storing control value or control data on the stack where you also store user data is a horrible design decision, but that's how it works. So you return, now your stack pointer and your base pointer are correctly set up for the function you were just in a second ago, and EIP points to whatever it was executing right before it called that instruction or called that function. So, okay, we did get this far. Okay, cool. So here's another quick exercise. Try to figure out what the stack frame looks like by the time it hits this printf. So notice there's a function main. Does it have local variables? Does it not? Does it pass arguments? If so, remember they get pushed right to left. Okay. Then it's going to call function 1. Does function 1 have local arguments? Well, it looks like it does. Then it calls printf. Well, printf takes arguments. They get pushed right to left. So try to figure out what the stack frame looks like. Spend 5 minutes on it. Remember, EBP is going to be saved, and the saved return value is going to be on the stack as well. So just start in main and just work through it. And I'm happy to answer any questions. But try to figure that out. I don't know. Yeah, good. We're on 70.
Great.
So we'll finish this, and we'll go over it, and that'll be about it. Yeah. Okay. Cool. So that's good. I'll get to do some debugging stuff.
Yeah. We'll just transfer over. Use VirtualBox or VMware?
VMware. It won't matter as long as you have any 32-bit Linux system, that's fine. You just need to have GCC.
I think all of my
Okay. Or do you have access to some SSH box in the school you can just...
Yeah.
So that string, which one, Sally or? Okay, so they're both the same actually. That's going to be a globally initialized variable. So that's going to be in the data section. So all that's going to be passed there is a pointer. So just an address is going to be pushed on.
Same as 29.
Yes. 29 is just going to be the actual number 29. Actually, I forgot to change that on the solution. I think I wrote Sally in there instead of whatever. Is anybody willing to write what they think is right on the board, and then we can see if we can figure it out and let you guys do it? Anybody willing to write it up on the board and take a chance? Yeah, go ahead, man. Perfect, yeah, looks great. Okay, perfect. Good, okay. So, that's great. So you start off in main. So he's exactly right. So main is gonna have its stack set up the way you expect. It has return and EBP. So if there were any local variables, they would go next, which there's not. There's a call of function one. They get arguments get passed right to left. So the address of Sally, Sally's gonna be a globally, or it's gonna be an initialized global variable. So that's gonna be in the data section. That would just be an address, 29. And you make that call to function one. So that return address gets saved. That function one starts off with its prologue and pushes the base pointer. Now if there's any room for locals, which there is, real age, it's gonna subtract from ESP4 or however the compiler wants to do it, but there's a local variable real age which goes right there. Now the call to printf happens and they get passed right to left. So whatever real age contains at that point in time gets pushed. The address to name, right? Yeah, so name gets pushed, which this is actually gonna be EBP plus 8, right, or plus 12. Yeah, the second argument. So this is actually EBP plus 12. And then that first string to print the first argument, so they got pushed right to left. That's again gonna be in the data section again. That's great, that's perfect. So that's good. Okay, so how do you guys feel about that? Are there questions? Like, do you feel sort of comfortable? Yeah.
Why is it 31 and then
32? 31. Oh, yeah, I think it's supposed to be 31 or whatever.
Oh.
Yeah, yeah. Questions? Most faces look good, but I see a couple confused ones.
Feel free to speak up.
Yeah.
I think I may have missed your explanation of the very top part of the stack there, where it's parentheses dot dot dot, or parentheses quote dot dot dot.
So the call to printf?
Yeah.
So this is the call to printf. And just like the call to function one, the arguments get pushed right to left. So in this case, function one, the rightmost argument is Sally, and then 29. So the address of Sally, and then 29. So when we come to the printf, the rightmost argument is real age, so that gets pushed. Real age in this case is a local variable, so that's gonna be EBP minus 4. Then name, which is second argument, that's EBP plus 12, but the second argument is plus 8 is the first argument. And then this is a string that's going to be stored in the data section. So, well, yeah, anyways.
That's really high. I bet you aren't really years old yet. That's that string.
Do what?
That's where the high, I bet you are really, like, years old.
Yeah, exactly. So those are the three arguments. Real age, name, and that string that's stored statically. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Anything else? Yeah.
If that argument was a different data type, with a larger data type, it would be at a different address, right? It would be plus 12, it would be plus whatever.
So.
Or is it always like?
It's always going to be. It's always going to be plus 4, plus 8, plus 12, plus 16. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because it's going to be passed by reference. So if I were to pass a character pointer of 100 bytes, it's just going to put that address. So it's always going to be 4 bytes because of 32-bit system. Yeah, that's right. Anything else? Okay. Cool, well, that was great. I'm glad we made it that far. I'm going to add more stuff to part two. It's going to be a lot more debugging. This was almost all static. There's a little bit more. I go into IDA. There is an exercise you guys will like, hopefully. And then I'll add more debugging. So that was great. We did a lot more than I was expecting. That was good. Cool. So that's it, guys. If you have any questions, feel free to ask me.
Thank you. last example, while there are two real edges.
I'm sorry, do what?
Just if you can open the presentation again, the PPT or the PDF. Yeah, just the place you just open up.
I just closed it. I was trying to see where he keeps it. Why the fuck can I not open it? Let's see where he stored it. I don't know. Maybe it's on the desktop. Hey, Owen, where's the presentation at? I closed it, but
it won't be now.
I thought it might be on the desktop, but.